Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us online. We are thrilled that you are with us this morning. It's a wonderful day to worship a great Savior. Before we get going, would you do us a favor and check in on the comments below? Maybe you'll just say, hey, the Spiller family is here. And, you know, maybe even greet a couple people like a virtual meet and greet. We'll give you about 30 seconds to do that. One of the things that we want to encourage you is maybe you're watching this service on a laptop or a TV or a phone. We want to encourage you to engage with us. You know, worship is not a spectator sport. It requires participation. And so wherever you are, whatever room you are in, we encourage you. Maybe you want to sing. Maybe you want to bow down. Maybe you want to stand. Whatever the case may be, don't let this opportunity to meet with God pass you by. We're thrilled that you are here. Will you join me in prayer as we get going? Dear Lord Jesus, we want to say that we love you. We want to say that we want to worship you and honor you. So won't you be glorified in our midst? As we lift you up, would you visit us with your presence? And it's in the mighty and holy name of Jesus that we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's worship.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare his praise?
Blessed are those who act justly, who always do what's right.
Remember me, Lord, when you show favor to your people.
Come to my aid when you save them, that I may enjoy the prosperity of your chosen ones.
That I shall share in the joy of your nation, and join in your inheritance in giving praise.
Hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Behind your regrets and mistakes, come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
A number of years ago, when my kiddos were much younger than they are now, I was putting them to bed, and one of my sons was afraid to go to bed for whatever reason. And I didn't know if this was a ploy to stay up later or if he really had some concerns about going to bed. And so we talked about it for a little bit, and he was clearly very scared for whatever reason of going to bed that night. And so I asked my son, "Would you like me to pray with you?" And he said, "Yes, Dad." And so we spent some time in prayer. And then at the end, I gave him a big hug. I kissed him, told him that I loved him. And I started to walk out the door. And he said, "Hey, Dad, wait, wait." I said, "What, buddy?" He said, "Dad, it didn't work." I said, "What didn't work?" He said, "Your prayer, it didn't work. I'm still scared." And so we had a conversation about this idea that, buddy, even if you are still scared, whenever you pray, God always does something. God is always at work. And you may not see the results right away, but God always does something. Do you believe that?" And he said, "Yeah, I believe that, and I'm scared, but okay." And so I left, and a couple nights later, we went through the regular routine of putting him to bed. And as I was walking out, I heard him praying, "Lord, please don't give me any nightmares. Please help me not to be afraid of the dark." And it was just a beautiful moment. I wish you could have seen it. It was a beautiful moment of a young boy expressing his faith in God. In that moment, his faith was becoming his own, not just his dad's or his mother's. And you know what? What God was doing in his life, God wants to do in your life as well. You see, God, you can trust God. You can come before God and lift up your prayer concerns, even when things look dark and bleak, even when you're wondering, is God even doing anything? We can trust that He is always at work when we pray. And so that's what we want to do for these next few moments. We want to pray. And if you find yourself in one of those places where things are dark and just you have these what-if questions and you don't know where to go or where to turn to God. And you can put your prayer request in the comments below. And we have people right now who will be willing to pray for you. Their whole job this morning is to watch this service and pray for your prayer requests. And so, again, you can put them in the comments below. And if you have something that's a little bit more sensitive in nature, you can email us at prayer@parkgate.org. And again, we have people ready to pray for you and whatever you are going through. You don't have to go through it alone. Let us pray with you.
Because there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. In your presence, Lord, cause I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord,
sing it out together.
And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, my God. nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord.
Let's sing it out together.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory,
pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, some of us in circumstances that are less than ideal. Many of us are certainly not in places that we want to be, Lord. But in these times, in these places, in these situations where we find ourselves in a time of hardship and trial, may we remember to rejoice. May we remember to find peace. Because, Lord, the life that you call us to does not often put us in places that keep us comfortable. You challenge us, Lord. You ask us to grow in you. You ask us to draw closer to you each and every day. And sometimes, Lord, that puts us in a pretty hard place. That puts us in a place where we're uncomfortable, where we don't know what to expect next. But in those times, may we simply trust in you, rely upon you, and find joy through you. because, Lord, you have given us such a wonderful gift to spend eternity with you. May we simply focus upon that rather than dwelling on where we are currently at. May we find peace, contentment, and joy in the midst of troubling times, because we have something so much greater than our present circumstances, and that is our relationship with you. We thank you, Lord. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
One way I've learned to rejoice this season is to be grateful for my life, my family, and my church. Thanks, God.
One way I'm learning to rejoice in this season is to focus on things that I'm thankful for. Some of those things are the extra time that I have to work out, which has resulted in lowering my medication. Also, time to read. So far, I've read 5 books. Time to watch things on Right Now Media. For Easter week, David and I watched an Easter series, so that was pretty awesome. Also, that time that I've been able to spend with David, that precious quality time. And lastly, but most importantly, to be thankful for God's faithfulness.
In this season, God has taught me to let go and let God be God in this crazy pandemic, because we're not in control of it, but God is, and he has a purpose for everything in this world.
One way I'm learning to rejoice in this season is by recognizing that short-term uncertainty exists, but understanding that joy comes by focusing on the long-term hope of my faith.
One way I'm learning to rejoice in this season is by taking the time to enjoy the peace that comes from a very, very busy life, and finding time in that peace to do more of the little hobbies and things that I love.
One way I've come to rejoice in this season is standing on the promises and resting in the presence of God. For the promises of God are yes and amen to the glory of the Father. And in God's presence there is fullness of joy, and in his right hand there are pleasures forevermore.
One way I'm learning to rejoice in this season is just slowing down, taking time to live moment by moment, to reconnect with family and friends, to watch families get out of their normal routines, be forced to slow down, to spend time together, to reconnect, to cook together, to go outside for walks together. It's been a very nice blessing to me.
One way that I've learned to rejoice during this season is by enjoying the peace. Now that there's no distractions, we have lots of extra time to spend time together. We take walks and play games, and I've had time to read the Bible, and I'm just really grateful for all this extra time that we've had together as a family. Once all this is over, I don't want to lose sight of all the moments that we've been able to spend together, and I don't want to be distracted, so that way we can be still aware of each other and all the things that are really truly important.
Ever need some stress relief at work? Do you need a good gift for somebody who's going through a hard time at their job? Well, I ran across a product that's just for you. For the sake of the kids watching, let's say it's called a Dang It doll. You're supposed to take this doll and grab it by the legs and use it to take out whatever aggression that you have on the doll so that you don't take that aggression out on somebody else. Every doll actually has a poem attached to it. Here's what the poem actually says. Whenever things don't go so well and you want to hit the wall and yell, here's a little dang it doll that you can't do without. Just grab it firmly by the legs and find a place to slam it. And as you whack the stuffing out, yell, well, you get the idea. This doll reflects a common belief entrenched in our culture called catharsis. Catharsis is the idea that if you express your anger and your aggression and you get rid of it, then you'll feel better and things will sort of go back to normal. So if you throw a doll, if you hit a punching bag, if you shout at a person in an angry way, you'll feel better. That's the idea. You think it works? No. In fact, the opposite is actually true. After decades of experimental research, here's the conclusion that researchers have come to. When people vent their feelings, their anger, in an aggressive way, they actually feel worse. They run a higher blood pressure. They actually make themselves angrier by expressing that aggression, that anger. The first time this was discovered, actually, was in a psychology department experiment at Harvard. The experimenter was designed to sort of help them to express their catharsis. So he thought that if people could express their anger, it would go away. So he posed himself as a medical technician. And the experiment was supposed to be about taking vitals from different college students in this experiment. And the researcher, though, when he walked in, he acted annoyed as he's taking their blood pressure. And because he was annoyed, he insulted them or made some kind of offensive comments to them. Guess what happened? The people who were being studied, they got angry. Their blood pressure went up. Now, after that happened, half of the group that was in the study was allowed to complain and vent their anger to this supposed technician supervisor, thinking that they would get him into trouble. The other half couldn't vent their anger, they couldn't complain. Now here's what the researcher assumed would happen. He assumed that the ones that couldn't complain would be angrier and maintain their anger, but the ones that actually could complain to the supervisor, they'd feel better, everything would be okay. Catharsis, right? Well, here's what happened. The ones that actually complained had greater animosity, higher blood pressure, even though they had the opportunity to express their anger. Those who could not complain, they soon returned to normal. Now, because the students thought that they were getting that technician into trouble, that half of that group, they had to justify their anger and their actions in their mind, convincing themselves that that guy really deserved to have his supervisor hear about his behavior. That actually made them angrier and made their blood pressure higher in return. Researchers call this the spiral of violence. Here's kind of how it works. You've heard it before. The boss yells at dad. Dad comes home, he yells at mom. Mom gets mad, she yells at the kids. The kids have no other place to express themselves, so they kick the dog, right? The violence spiral works that way. Then everyone, after that happens, claims some version of, he started it, he deserved it. Well, five-year-olds do this to their little brothers, and we think, oh, well, they shouldn't do that, but that's what five-year-olds do. But the problem is, street gangs use the same logic when they bully others. Bosses sometimes use the same logic to mistreat their workers. Cops sometimes use that same logic when they go too far with a suspect. Tyrants use that same logic when they oppress people in their country. Soldiers use that same logic when they commit war crimes. Aggression begets justification, self-justification, which begets, guess what? More aggression. This is the way the world works. You know it as well as I do. And we're miserable because of it. You don't believe me? Watch President Trump's press conference tomorrow. If you like President Trump, you'll be disgusted by the way that the press asks him the questions that they ask him, and you'll find it very easy to excuse his reactions. If you don't like President Trump, you'll be disgusted by his reactions, and you'll find it very easy to excuse the behavior of the press. In fact, I bet, depending upon which side you're on, you've already decided your reaction while you heard me say that sentence. Take a random sample of the latest controversy in social media. You know how we're so convinced that somebody else's rant's never going to convince us, but we think somehow our rant will convince them. It never works, but we still try it. Think honestly about the last time that you had a fight with your spouse. Actually, you'll probably already justify your actions, so don't think about the fight you had with your spouse. Think about the last time you witnessed another couple fight. Maybe then you can be a little bit more objective. You know, even while we were preparing for this sermon, I got in an argument with my daughter over cornbread. I couldn't even speak with her in a gentle way while writing a sermon on gentleness. Lord, help us. The cycle touches everyone, doesn't it? Do you really want to reflect that spirit? I don't. It may be the way that the world works, but I don't want it to be the way my world works. Here's the way Paul put it in Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. That's the spirit I want to reflect. And I don't want it some other day. I want it now. I want my gentleness, the gentleness that Jesus put in me, to be evident to all. This important verse is governed by the verse we looked at last week, the one that precedes it, Philippians 4:4. Look at that again. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. So true and lasting joy is not found, remember we said last week, if we get what we desire. True and lasting joy is only realized when we understand what we deserved in Jesus and then understand what we received in Him. We deserved His judgment. We received His mercy and grace. And when we understand that, our lives are filled with this everlasting joy that changes and permeates everything, which gives us, back to verse 5, that spirit of gentleness. Gentleness is one of the fruitful outcomes of God's gift of joy. Because of Jesus' work in our lives, our character is reformed, and we take on gentleness. Now, in verse 5, that word gentleness was actually a tricky word to translate. Here in the Greek, it's the word epikles, okay? Which means a gentle patience or self-control with others. So depending upon your Bible translation, you have a range of meanings from graciousness to reasonableness to consideration to a gentle spirit or, like the NIV says that we use, gentleness. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Now let's get at what this gentleness is about by first maybe describing what it isn't, okay? The opposite of gentleness, this spirit, is a spirit that's contentious or self-seeking. You know that a contentious spirit means that you're argumentative, right? You're picking fights all the time. And a self-seeking spirit is somebody who's selfish or maybe taken to the extreme, narcissistic. A contentious person can include anyone from that schoolyard bully who's always picking on somebody to the person stoking the latest outrage on Facebook or Twitter. They live in an us versus them world where there's always an enemy out there that needs to be crushed and they're out to crush them. A self-seeking person can include anybody from, say, a vain teenager to a celebrity A-lister from Hollywood where the world is always revolving around them. It's about them all the time. Their desires are all that matters. And if their desires aren't being met, they'll roll over anyone who gets in their way. Let's be clear. There is nothing of Jesus in a contentious or self-seeking spirit. Nothing at all. And wherever we reflect it, whenever we reflect it, and wherever it's seen, and it will be seen in us, well, we have to repent. We don't excuse it. We don't minimize it. We don't look the other way. We deal with it. We repent of it. Of course, the one who reflected this gentleness best was Jesus. Paul describes Jesus this way in chapter 2. Here's what he says about Jesus. Who, being in the very nature God, see, Jesus was God completely, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Instead, rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, he left heaven to come to earth, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Jesus was not contentious. Jesus was not self-seeking. He gave up everything for us. Jesus could have crushed us in righteous judgment because of our sin. all the bad things that we've ever done, said, or thought, all the good things that we should have done, should have said, should have thought, but didn't do. And including all the good things that we did, but we did it for all the wrong reasons, selfish reasons perhaps, self-serving reasons. That list is endless. We're guilty. Jesus could have crushed us in righteous judgment, but he didn't. Instead, Jesus sacrificed his life on the cross to save us. He put our interests above his own. He served us by paying the price for our sin. Jesus is gentleness personified. Jesus has been so gentle with me. When I really reflect on that, I can't fully express how much Jesus has been gentle with me. I'm so thankful. I know that I don't fully appreciate what that means. Even at my best, I don't fully appreciate it. I know that there are times, and I'm embarrassed to say it, but I know that there are times that I've taken it for granted. But even though I fail to adequately praise and obey Jesus, it doesn't change his gentleness toward me. It doesn't. It doesn't diminish his gentleness towards me. It doesn't diminish his love that he expresses towards me ever. You know, Jesus has been gentle with you, too. I know that you haven't lived the same life that I've lived. Maybe your circumstances were so much better than mine. Maybe, compared to my life, your life has been awful. Your circumstances have been horrible. Maybe things happened to you that were totally outside of your control. Maybe things happened because evil people did things to hurt you. Maybe things happened that were just actually a result of your own bad choices. Maybe you faithfully tried to follow Jesus. Maybe, if you're honest, listening to this message is the first time you've paid any attention to Jesus in a long, long time. Guess what? None of those things has changed Jesus' gentleness toward you. Jesus' gentleness toward you is a constant that never changes and will never go away. Now take a moment, right now, and take in the reality of Jesus' gentleness with you. He's not angry. He's not contentious. He's not self-seeking. Jesus is loving. He's patient. Jesus is merciful with you. He's gracious. If you don't know him, he wants you to know his gentleness. He wants you to know that your sins can be forgiven in him. He wants you to know that your old life can be transformed and made new. He wants you to know that you can be right with God for eternity. Jesus wants you to know true peace. He wants you to know real and lasting joy. If you do know Jesus, he wants you to be so tapped into his gentleness that it naturally flows in and out of you wherever you go, in and out, every day, every day. His gentleness in you will transform you and make you more gentle with others. Jesus' gentleness actually makes you gentle. Friends, here's the main thing that we have to know. Jesus' gentleness in us creates a spiral of gentleness towards others. There are four quick examples. There are millions of them, but there are four I just want to lift up that I think can speak to the world that we're living in right now. The first one is that, you know, your tone can be intentionally softer and kinder than the world around you. I get it. People around us are so quick to get angry, to insult others, to cuss them out. Their first reaction is to fight. Get out of that spiral. You don't have to be in that spiral anymore. People will still cross you. People will still hurt you. People will still insult you. That's reality. You can't control them. But as a Christian, the gentleness of Jesus can lower your voice instead of raise it. And the gentleness of Jesus can make it so there are certain tones in your life that you just will never go to. You'll be in a totally different tone because of him. There are certain words you will never speak because they're just out of bounds because the gentleness of Jesus is flowing in you. Second thing I would say is this, that Christians can show the world that politics doesn't have to be so divisive. I know you're rolling your eyes right now, but it doesn't have to be that way. People don't just disagree politically now, they become enemies. Well, we got to get out of that spiral. You may be to the left or you may be to the right politically, but as a Christian, the gentleness of Jesus governs what you say and how you say it. It doesn't make you silent, but it will make you perhaps a better listener, even to people who disagree with you. It also makes you a person who seeks dialogue and mutual understanding and isn't out there to battle your enemies until they're crushed. Expressing your convictions, here's a third thing, can build bridges instead of walls. Make time, many take time, and they just spoil the beauty of Jesus by getting into arguments about him. Instead of people being challenged by the gospel, do you know what they do when we just start making arguments about him? They get offended by us. We have to get out of that spiral. Standing for Jesus will cause people to disagree with us. That's the way it is. But the gentleness of Jesus, when it's working in and through us, can actually gain us a true hearing with people who are different from us. His gentleness in us will build bridges with them, even people who disagree with us, even people who disagree with us big time. And it will force them, cause them to think through what we're saying and probably create more conversation. And here's the last thing. Because of the gentleness of Jesus, we can lead the way in modeling peace and reconciliation. So many people live right on the edge of the next fight, right? That next fight's going to ruin that friendship for good. It's going to cause the divorce to happen. It's going to alienate that family member for years. That's normal. But it doesn't have to be our normal. Let's get out of that spiral. Because Jesus has been so gentle with us, our hearts, friends, have the capacity to be gentle with others, even those who hurt us. That's true. The gentleness of Jesus can help us take responsibility for our actions. It can make us the first people in the conversation to say, "I'm sorry," when we're wrong. It can even help us talk through issues directly, but in a way that's peaceful. Don't miss how Paul finished this verse out. He said, "The Lord is near. Let your gentleness be evident to all." Why? The Lord is near. Now, maybe Paul meant that Jesus was coming soon, so they needed to be found living gently and living gentle lives that aren't contentious, that aren't self-seeking. Maybe Paul meant that Jesus' presence was close and ready to help them live gentle lives. Maybe he meant both, because both are true. Jesus is coming back. And we should live differently now in obedience to him in light of the fact that he's returning. And we are commanded to be gentle. It's not a suggestion. So we have to obey him. But the other bit is true too. Jesus is near us. He wants us to call upon him. Being gentle only happens by God's power. You and I simply aren't disciplined enough to be gentle on our own. So call on him for help in order to be gentle. Remember the harsh words that I talked about earlier? Of all things over cornbread with my daughter, that's happening literally as I'm writing this sermon. It's sad, but it's true. Now, those harsh words and that argument wasn't all on me. But my reaction and my words and my tone, they were on me. They were anything but gentle. It didn't take long for the Holy Spirit to just sort of hit me upside the head and say, "What are you doing here?" And when I became aware of that, what was I to do? Should I have pulled a parental power play? I'm the parent, you're the child, listen. Should I have justified my actions? Should I have made excuses? Should I have resolved to do better next time, but not actually talk about it now? None of those were the options I had as a Christian. No, I needed to take responsibility for me. I had to say that I was sorry for what I said and the way I said it. I had to speak gently. I had to resolve the issue. Sadly, there probably will be another time where the gentleness of Jesus will be absent from the way I speak and the tone that I speak it, the words that I say. That's reality. But because of the gentleness of Jesus working in me by the power of the Holy Spirit, those times will be fewer and fewer. And when they come, I have to take responsibility and deal with them. Because I want Jesus' spirit of gentleness to create a spiral of gentleness in my life that reaches out and touches others. Don't you want Jesus' gentleness in your life too? Don't you want that spiral? First thing, don't forget how gentle Jesus has been with you. Take it in. Realize it. Thank Him for it. Now, allow His gentleness to flow out of you and make you gentle with others. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You for Your immense gentleness towards us. We didn't deserve it. We've rebelled against You more times than we could ever count. We've ignored You more times than we can ever count. We pray, God, that You would forgive us for that. But we thank You for Your immense gentleness towards us. We needed it so much. We need it so much right now. Help us, God, to just take in the reality of Your gentleness more and more and more. If we don't know You, God, right now as we pray, we invite the Holy Spirit of Jesus to transform our life, to forgive us of our sins, for His mercy to wash over us, for His grace to wash over us, for His Holy Spirit to live in us and make us a new creation, that we would be different from this time forward in You. We invite Your gentleness to invade our life. If we do know You, God, then we invite Your gentleness to so permeate us that it will be evident to all, including our families and our co-workers and our neighbors and even strangers, because the Lord is near. You've called us to obey, and You've called us to call upon You for help, and we're doing that. Fill us with Your gentleness and make us gentle toward others. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jim, for those words. May we put those words into practice by being gentle with one another this week. We would like to remind you that there are a number of ways that you can give here at Podgate. You can give through our website via text, and you can also mail in your checks as well. And we want to thank you for your generosity during this time, as we are the light in our community. We also want to highlight one other way that we can be the light in our community. As you can imagine, the food pantries in our city and around the greater Houston area are very low right now, as there's such a need for food. And so the city has asked us, Parkgate and other churches in the area, to partner with them in a food drive. This week, we will send out emails with specific items that they are looking for. And next Wednesday, from 10 to 2, we will collect those items. So you can bring them to the church, drop them off, and we'll make sure that the city gets them. We'll replenish food pantries around our city, including our own. And this is just another way that we can fulfill our theme verse. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Go love God, love people, love now. I hope you have a great week. Bless you.